Good morning students. Today we are going to see discrete time signal processing. The reference books for this discrete time signal processing, Proc is Dr. Ramesh Babu, Oppenheim and Schaffer, and one more book, Dr. Palani. Dear students, you please try to understand, it does not matter how much we can do, but what we do must get in print in your mind. Okay? So you try to slowly understand the subject, right? Now we'll go to the subject. Now, what is digital signal processing? I'm going to tell about what is digital, what is signal, and what is processing. Digital, actually it is nothing but it is being used to represent data as a sequence of discrete values. You have already studied what is digital, right? Now, what is actually signal? Signal is a function that conveys information about a phenomenon. And what is processing? A series of operations performed according to programmed functions, according to programmed instructions, is called processing. Clear? Right. Actually, first we concentrate on what is signal, right? See, actually I told about what is digital, what is signal, what is processing, but first we concentrate on what is signal in digital signal processing. So, signal, actually it is a function that conveys information, right? And more. Actually, theoretical way, I can say signal in mathematical term, it is a function. A function is a dependent variable of some independent variable. The number of independent variable is one or more. Clear? So, signal, I can represent f of x1, x2, x3. Right? Now, where xi is time, distance and temperature. Now we'll go to the next slide. Okay, in this course we shall mostly be concerned with a function of single variable, and that variable will be time. Okay, but because of we are talking of DSP, time shall also lose its significance. Our functions will be functions of numbers, and numbers also restricted to be integer. What I mean to say is, actually in DSP, the type of signals that we shall be considered with a function of variables small n, where small n can take only integer values. That is, the integer values can be plus, minus, plus or minus. That is, it can take, say for example, minus 15, plus 0 or plus 15. Nothing like 13.5. 13.5 and all, it is not permitted because time is discretized. Clear? Right. Now, we'll see what are the various types of signals. Signals can be one-dimensional, two-dimensional and multi-dimensional. Okay? Right? Now, actually, we can talk more about signals. Signals can be natural. For example, a thunderstorm lightning, it is a natural signal. Actually, it is a natural phenomenon. Okay? Or I can say that a signal can be synthetic. It can be generated in the laboratory for communication purpose. Clear? Right. Now, signals can be either analog or discrete. Right? Analog or discrete. And it is discrete signal that we are concerned with in this course. Clear? Right. But generally, one common confusion is that all continuous time signals are also called as analog signal. But all analog signals are not continuous time. It's clear? If the time is discretized but not the amplitude, that is, the time with the independent variable is discretized but not the dependent variable, it is still an analog signal, and therefore an analog signal can be either continuous or discrete time, right? Now we'll see that. Now we'll see types of analog signals. Actually, analog signals are classified as continuous time and discrete time. Okay, right? So if a discrete time signal is quantized, that is, if in a discrete time signal where the independent variable has been discretized, if the amplitude is also discretized, then that is, the amplitude is allowed to take on only certain values, then it is said to be discretized or quantized. So when it passes through an A to D converter, right, so then depending on the number of bits, for example, if it is 3 bit A to D, then 8 possible amplitudes are possible. I think it's clear. So after A to D, usually the signal after discretization in amplitude is also coded in some form, and the most usual form is the binary form. So the signal after being discretized is converted to a binary number, that is what we get a digital signal. I hope it is clear now, right? So why a signal, why should we strictly signal, we stuck at signals? Because signals convey information. It is information that derives the whole world. Information, transmission, reception, absorption, and so on. Right? I think now it is clear about a signal. Right? Now, we will see the types of signal. Types of signal, analog and digital. Right? This is types of signal, analog and digital. And here it is a periodic and aperiodic. In digital also, we can classify it as a periodic and aperiodic signal. Clear? Right. Now we'll see why processing, what is the need for processing. Actually, processing is done to obtain the given signal in a more desirable form. Or I can say to obtain the better quality of signal than the original one. For example, I can say that is noise filtering. Or I can say one more example, improving the quality of picture in terms of brightness or contrast, whatever it is. Okay, and we'll see what is actually processing means. I am going to give one example. There are number of signals which has to be transmitted through over the same channel. Then we do a processing called multiplexer. I think you might have studied this. At the receiver end, the signal have to be separated, and therefore we will do the demultiplexing because there is a need for demultiplexing. Clear? So this is called actually processing means, right? So basically there are actually, I told you, the two kinds of signal, right? So analog and digital. Analog is classified as continuous time and discrete time. Okay, a discrete time signal is not a digital signal. I am telling you again and again, a discrete time signal is not a digital signal, right? A discrete time is one in which the amplitude is continuous and not discretized. On the other hand, if the time is discretized, this signal is still analog only. When it passes through A to D, then it becomes the digital signal. I hope you understand this, right? So far I have explained about the signal. Now we'll see the taxonomy of a signal. So here we have amplitude, which is both continuous and discrete, and similarly we have time, which is continuous as well as discrete, right? So amplitude, which is continuous and discrete, and time also continuous and discrete. When both amplitude and time are continuous, then we are calling it as an analog signal. When amplitude is discrete, time is continuous, we'll call it as a continuous time signal. I will show you the different waveforms for all these. And next, when the amplitude is continuous, time is discrete, then it is called the discrete time signal. This discrete time signal only we are going to pass through an A to D, and finally we will get the digital signal, where we are discretizing both amplitude as well as time. Clear? Right. Next, we'll go to the, actually, as I told you, an analog signal where amplitude and time are continuous. That is, signals that are defined for all instant of time. And second one is continuous time signal that has values for all points in time and some possibly infinite interval. So the waveform actually I have shown here, right? And next, we have a discrete time signal that has values at discrete points in time. It can be finite, infinite precision samples of your continuous time signals. Okay, so this is actually x of n is equal to, we are representing it as x of n t. Okay, next, digital signal when both time and amplitude are that is discretized, we will get the digital signal. So the representation of digital signal is this. Okay, right. Next, we'll classify signals. Actually, classification of signals, it's a continuous time and discrete time signal, and we have even and odd signal, periodic and non-periodic signal, deterministic and random signals, energy and power signal. This you might have studied in signals and systems, so here also you can study. Actually, we have a signal processing. We were keep on talking about signal processing, and we were discussing about how we got the digital signal. Now, in the signal processing, actually here we have three types. One is analog, digital and mixed. Okay, so analog signal, right, this analog signal processing actually dominates prior to 70s. So in 1970s and all, if you see, only analog signal only dominates. Between 1970 and 2000, it is basically a digital signal processing which got dominance over analog signal, and the current trend is to have a mixed signal, right? So current trend is to have the mixed signal processing, naturally combination of digital and analog. Your mixed signal is nothing but combination of digital and analog signal. I think now it is clear about signal processing, right? Next. Okay, now we'll see why DSP, why not analog signal processing. Most of the signals in practice are analog, but DSP should be the natural choice if the signal is digital. Clear? Right. For example, the rainfall data at Chennai over the last 20 years, or you take last 10 years, on which it is based on predictions for the next year. Predictions always fail, sometimes fail miserably, as it has this previous year, right? But the data that you collect is a digital data only. For example, in 2010, so many inches of rainfall, and in 2011, so many inches of rainfall. So the amplitude can be continuous. So it is discrete time, but the amplitude or the number of inches of rainfall can also be coded to make it a digital signal. Clear? Or I can say, if you want to do DSP, then the amplitude or the height of rainfall can also be coded, but you see the time is discretized. Here it is like 2010, 2011, 2012, etc. or so on, and there is nothing between 2010 and 2011. Clear? Because the time is discretized. It is not like a 2010.5. It is not agreed. So the natural choice would be DSP, and this is what is done. Okay, so this data is fed with many other parameters controlling monsoon or rainfall to a supercomputer, which is basically a DSP processor, or which is basically does DSP. So what is DSP? Actually, what is your DSP will do? It will do addition, multiplication and delay, or delay in the sense recalling of past signals. These are the basic operations in DSP. Even if the signal is analog, one prefer to use DSP only. The reasons are actually many, and we will see the reasons one by one. Later, when we see the applications, we will see it one by one. Clear? Right. Next, we will go to the next slide. Implementation of DSP. So, I am giving an analog input signal, analog anti-aliasing filter. We will see this later. Right. And I am giving it to a sample and hold circuit, an analog to digital converter, A to D converter unit, and DSP algorithm, and digital to analog converter, and finally again we are converting an analog output amplifier. So what you are giving is an analog input, finally you are getting the analog output. So in between, this is PIC32 microprocessor, you have a sample and hold, analog to digital converter, and DSP algorithm, digital to analog converter. This is the way you need to implement the DSP. Clear? So in the previous slide, we have seen the implementation of DSP. So in discrete time signal processing, all the problems which we deal with, only Fourier. Why Fourier? Actually, what is the need for Fourier? Actually, all the signals are in time domain. Why should we go for a frequency domain? See, here I have explained with a prism. Right, the prism represents Fourier transform. Okay, that is, all the critical information about the signal lies at frequency domain. For example, the basic light is only sunlight only. Right, sunlight is the basic light. Okay, so using sunlight, we can achieve so many applications like that is V2R and UV rays and so on. Okay, so all the critical information actually about the signal lies at frequency domain only. Clear? Right. Now, if you see here, see again I have a question, what do we hope to achieve with the Fourier transform? Actually, we desire a measure of the frequencies present in a wave. This will lead to a definition of the term, the spectrum, what we have seen in the previous slide. Okay, so a monochromatic wave have only one frequency, right, and this light wave has many frequencies, and the frequency increase in time, right, from red to blue, right. So it will be nice if our measure is also tell us when each frequency occurs. Okay, that is what we are going for, a Fourier transform. Understand, please. Right. Next, actually, how your Fourier in DSP works? Actually, Fourier, we have two types. One is Fourier series and Fourier transform. Now, the same basic taxonomy of signal which we have seen, right? See, continuous and discrete. Clear? So, all periodic signals are represented with a Fourier series. All aperiodic signals are represented with a Fourier transform. Clear? See, this is time which is periodic and aperiodic, continuous and discrete. Okay, so periodic in the sense continuous and discrete aperiodic. Okay, so continuous periodic, I told you that all periodic with a Fourier series, right, all periodic signals. So discrete with a Fourier series, and next it is continuous time, right, and aperiodic. Right, so aperiodic is that is, we can represent with a Fourier transform. Aperiodic is represented with a Fourier transform. So all the discrete time signals represented with a Fourier transform only. Continuous time signals represent with a Fourier series. Okay, so discrete aperiodic signal can be represented only with the Fourier transform. It's clear? Actually, what is the big difference between a Fourier series and Fourier transform? In general, now I want to go and explain to a layman what is the difference between a Fourier series and Fourier transform. Actually, your Fourier series tells us how many types of rupee notes are there in your piggy bank. For example, you have 100 rupees note, 500 rupees note, 2000 rupees note in your piggy bank? Yes. If there is 100 rupees note, yes. If there is a 500 rupees note, yes. Right? So this is what your Fourier series. Your Fourier series tell us how many types of rupee notes are there. And what about your Fourier transform? Your Fourier transform tell us how many rupee notes are there. For example, 500 rupee notes, how many are there? 500 rupee notes, 100 notes are there, or 200 notes are there, like that. So for example, I told you 2000 rupees. So 2000 rupees, how many are there? Like 50 notes. Okay, your Fourier series tells whether these like 500, 2000, 100, it is there, yes or no? Yes. But Fourier transform only tells that how many number of 500 rupees notes are there and how many number of 2000 rupees notes are there. So all the critical information lies behind only the Fourier transform. So you can measure all the critical frequency information through Fourier transform. All critical information we can measure through Fourier transform. So all aperiodic signal can be measured through a Fourier transform. Clear? Okay. Next. Now, I can explain the Fourier series. Fourier series can be explained as, that is, any periodic signal can be represented, any periodic signal x of t. Okay. So any periodic signal can be represented in terms of infinite sum of harmonically related exponentials. Clear? Any periodic signal can be represented in terms of infinite sum of harmonically related exponential. You should remember this, right? So your x of t is actually when we resolve this component, when we resolve this summation a naught by 2, which is a DC component, and summation of n equal to 1 to infinity, it is purely AC component. Okay, that is, when it is periodic, we are summating minus infinity to plus infinity. Okay, so any signal can be expressed in terms of infinite sum of harmonically related sinusoids. Okay, right. So and this is what your Fourier series says. In digital signal processing, we have two F's. One is Fourier transform and filters. Fourier transform actually discrete and fast. Filters, IIR and FIR. Okay. Now we'll see advantages of a digital over analog signal processing. Actually, a digital system can be simply reprogrammed for other applications. Right. So DSP provides better control of accuracy requirements, and digital signals can be easily stored without any deterioration. Okay, and then more sophisticated signal processing algorithms can be implemented. Right. So next we will see. There is a limitation of DSP which is called that aliasing. Right. So when most signals are analog in nature, and we have to be sampled to avoid the loss of information. Okay. So we only take samples of the signals at intervals and don't know what happens in between. So what is happening here? There is a overlap of signals. It cannot distinguish between higher and lower frequencies. Right. So there will be a overlap of signal. So the sampling theorem says to avoid aliasing, sampling rate must be at least twice the maximum frequency component. Right. So we'll see what is sampling theorem in the next. Right. So the limitation of a DSP actually anti-aliasing filter. See, sampling theorem says that there is enough information to reconstruct the signal, which does not mean that the sampled signal looks like an original one. Okay. So the correct reconstruction is not just connecting samples with the straight lines. Okay. So you need anti-aliased filter. So which is used to filter out all high frequency components before sampling. Understand? So it is same for the reconstruction also. So it does remove information through. Right. And each sample is taken at early part of a cycle. clear? Right. And the limitation of DSP, right? See, most signals are analog in nature, and I told you that we have to be sampled, okay? So the limited, that is by the number of bits available, actually the precision in data and storage and arithmetic. So there is a quantization error. So this quantization error, actually the smoothly varying signal is represented by stepped waveform. This is actually the limitation of DSP. There will be a small quantization error occurs, okay, when we are sampling that. So that we can eliminate if we use the sampling theorem properly. We can eliminate quantization error also. Right. So now we'll come to the applications of DSP. It is worked in radar and sonar, okay, to target detection, position and velocity estimation, and tracking. Right. Next. And not only in engineering, it you can do the applications of DSP in biomedical also. So analysis of biomedical signals, diagnosis, patient monitoring, preventive health care, artificial organs, everything. Okay. For example, ECG signal provides doctor with the information about the condition of patient's heart. Okay. So it provides information about the activity of the brain also. Right. So using DSP, actually we can do many wonders. We'll see one by one. So application of DSP in speech, we can have the noise filtering I told you in the previous slide. So noise reduction, reducing background noise, okay, and speech recognition, that is you need to differentiate between a various speech sounds, and synthesis of artificial speech, okay. So that is also one of the application. And the next application is we can do the application of DSP in communications, okay. For example, telephony, transmission of information in digital from form via telephone lines. Now the modern technology, mobile phones, okay. Encoding and decoding of the information sent over a physical channel, that is to optimize the transmission or to detect or correct errors in transmission. Clear? And then the application of DSP in image processing also. So we have in image processing also, we can, that is instead of signal dip, digital image processing only we are going to do it, right? Next. Now the application of DSP in multimedia. So the generation and storage of transmission of sound, still images, motion pictures, all this, right? These are the multimedia applications. Next, application of DSP in music. See, music application, recording, playback, manipulation, everything, okay, you can do using DSP. Next, most application, there are more many application in automobiles. Actually automobiles are undergoing a digital makeover. See, less DSP, right? With the more DSP effects, how it looks like. Next, we have the application of DSP in embedded system also. Applications in telephone, mobile, camera, traffic system, and also in computer. So far we have seen the application. Actually we have so much of story to tell about the digital signal processing, but I've shortened the story, okay. I hope you would have understand what I taught so far, and now you can go to the next session of DSP. Thank you so much.